أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. Dear viewers, respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the 43rd episode of our series Mercy to Mankind. In this episode, we shall look at the activities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, after Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. In the previous two episodes, we saw the incident of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was prevented from making Umrah, and finally how a treaty was concluded between the people of Quraysh and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the reaction of the Sahaba who wanted to go out for a war with the people of Quraysh. However, looking at the greater benefits that Islam would gain from this treaty, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose to go into a treaty with the people of Quraysh rather than war. And the results of this treaty, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called in the Quran as Fatham Mubina, were visible in a small time span of just 2 years. As many scholars have made this analysis, that just in this time span of 2 years, more people accepted Islam than in the previous 19 years, than in the previous 19 to 18 years. This was the impact the Treaty of Hudaybiyah had on the Arabian Peninsula, in fact beyond the Arabian Peninsula as well. In this episode, inshallah, we shall see how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrote letters to kings and rulers of the different empires of that time, inviting them to Islam. Before the Treaty of Hudaybiyah was signed, most of the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was spent dealing with the people of Quraysh and the other internal enemies in the Arabian Peninsula, and he could not focus on spreading the message of Islam beyond the Arabian Peninsula. However, after the Quraysh signed this treaty and went into a state of peace, and the other sub-tribes of the Arabian Peninsula, when they saw that our leader Quraysh themselves have laid down their weapons, their hostilities too, it subsided to a great level. After this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the opportunity to spread Islam beyond the Arabian Peninsula, and we see he wrote letters to the major empires of that time, including the Roman Empire, the Persian Empire, the kingdom which was in Abyssinia, the kingdom in Yemen and Bahrain, the kingdom in Egypt. All of these empires and rulers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrote letters to them, inviting them to Islam. And this was a clear announcement by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Islam is not a religion for the Arabs, nor does Islam aim to uplift the Arabs alone. In fact, Islam is a universal religion. Islam is a universal religion meant for each and every race, for each and every person living on this planet. And once a person enters the fold of Islam, there is no difference between him and an Arab, no difference of race and culture. All of these things remain as an identity. However, the virtue in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is based solely on the Islam of a person. The better a person's Islam, the better a person's fear of Allah, the more a person's Iman, such a person is much higher in the status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the other person who might be of a race considered to be superior among the people, but is low in his Iman and Taqwa. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dispatched various messengers to these kingdoms and wrote letters inviting them to Islam, and we shall see some of these letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this episode. A foreword mentioned to you that some of these kings, they accepted Islam. Some of these kings, though they did not accept Islam yet, they welcomed the ambassador of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They showed a keen interest in the religion of Islam, and they returned this letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a very warm reply and gifts sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And yet there were others who rejected the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as a result of their actions, as a consequence of their actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tore them. He tore their arrogance and he tore their kingdom apart. And we shall see who were such kings and emperors of that time. One of the kings to whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dispatched a letter was the king of Abyssinia, known as An-Najashi. We have already seen that An-Najashi was a just and a fair ruler, a kind-hearted king, whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whose assistance was sought by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was in Makkah, and he sent Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala anhu along with a group of Sahaba so that they go and peacefully stay in the land of Abyssinia. And after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent a letter to him as well, inviting him to Islam. And the king, An-Najashi, whose name was Ashamah, he responded to this invitation and he surrendered himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He accepted Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrote to him, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, from Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to An-Najashi, the king of Abyssinia. Abyssinia, that is known as Ethiopia today. Peace be upon him who follows true guidance. To proceed, I praise Allah. There is no God but He, the Sovereign, the Holy, the Source of Peace, the Giver of Peace, the Guardian of Faith, the Preserver of Safety. I bear witness that Jesus, that is Isa alaihi salam, is the son of Maryam, and is the Spirit of Allah and His word which He cast into Maryam, the Virgin, the Good, the Pure, so that she conceived Jesus. So she conceived Him from Allah's Spirit and breathing, as He created Adam by His hand. I call you to Allah alone, with no associate, to His obedience, and to follow me, and to believe in that which came to me. I am the Messenger of Allah. I invite you and your men to Allah the Glorious, the Almighty. I hereby witness that I have communicated my message and advice. I invite you to listen and accept my advice. Peace be upon him who follows true guidance. This was the message which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to An-Najashi. And some narrations also mention that he, along with this text of this letter, he also wrote this ayah of the glorious Quran, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. An ayah of the Quran which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose, and as we shall see, not only to An-Najashi but to the other kings as well, he specifically quoted this ayah of the Quran, which is directly addressing them. Say, O people of the book, come to common terms between us and you. Allah na'buda illallah, that we worship none but Allah, and that none of us should take each other as gods besides Allah, as deities besides Allah. فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَقُولُوا اشْهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ. If you turn back, then say that I am from the Muslimin. I am from the one who surrender themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When An-Najashi got this letter, and we have already seen that when Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala and who recited Suratul Maryam upon him, contrary to what the Christians and what the Christendom believed at that time about the divinity of Isa alayhi salam, since the time Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala and who had recited Suratul Maryam upon him, in fact from before that as well, An-Najashi was aware of the fact that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Isa alayhi salam, is nothing but a messenger of Allah like the other messengers who came before him. Not the son of Allah, nor himself is he Allah. And finally, when this letter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam reached An-Najashi, he couldn't hold himself, but he accepted Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to Islam, and Najashi wrote back a reply to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in which he wrote, "In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful," from Ashama An-Najashi to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the messenger of Allah, "May peace be upon you, O Prophet of Allah." He attested to the prophethood of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and addressed him saying, "O Prophet of Allah, and mercy and blessings from Allah, besides whom there is no God. I have received your letter in which you mentioned about Isa, and by the Lord of the heavens and the earth, Isa, Jesus, is not more than what you say. We fully acknowledge that which you have been sent to us with, and we have entertained your cousin and his companions. I bear witness that you are the messenger of Allah, true, and confirming those who have gone before you. I pledge to you through your cousin, and surrender myself through him to the Lord of the worlds." So An-Najashi, on the hands of Ja'far bin Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, became a Muslim. And when he passed away, when An-Najashi passed away, and this was in the 9th year of Hijrah, when all the Muslims in Abyssinia had migrated back to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, through wahi, through revelation, was informed that Najashi, who is a Muslim, has passed away. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam informed his companions of his demise. Not only did he do this, but he also made Salatul Janazah for Najashi. Salatul Janazah, though Najashi was not in front of him, but yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam offered Salatul Janazah for An-Najashi. This was the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to An-Najashi. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also sent a letter to Muqawqis. To Muqawqis, who was the king of Egypt, and the letter read, "Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, from Muhammad, the servant of Allah and his messenger, to Muqawqis, the leader of the Copts. Peace be upon him who follows true guidance. Assalamu ala man ittaba'a al-huda. May peace be upon him who follows the true guidance. Thereafter, I invite you to accept Islam. Therefore, if you want security, accept Islam. If you accept Islam, Allah the Sublime shall reward you double. But if you refuse to do so, you will bear the burden of the transgression of all Copts." And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned the same ayah of the glorious Quran, "Qul ya ahla al-kitab ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa'in baynana wa baynakum," that, "O people of the book, come to common terms as between us and you." Hatib bin Abi Balta radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was chosen to deliver this letter to Muqawqis. Hatib bin Abi Balta radiyallahu ta'ala anhu also tried to convince Muqawqis from his side about the truthfulness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because this king was a Christian, Hatib bin Abi Balta tried to remind him of the previous prophets, and that how believing in the previous prophets was necessary, and so is believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He told him that, "O king, just like you call the people of Torah, the Jews, to believe in Isa alayhi salam, because Isa alayhi salam too is a prophet, similarly we call you to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Just like Musa alayhi salam gave glad tidings about the coming of Isa alayhi salam, so did Isa alayhi salam give the glad tidings about the arrival of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So just like you want the Jews to believe in your prophet, similarly it becomes incumbent upon you, based on this same principle, that you believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam." The king pondered, he thought over the contents of the letter, he thought over the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and reached the conclusion, which he said, that this prophet is indeed a prophet, and he calls to things that are not bad. However, the king did not embrace Islam, but he was indeed certain that the message which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has brought is the truth, but there were things that prevented him from guidance. And Muqawqas then wrote back a reply to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in which he wrote, "In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful, from Muqawqas to Muhammad bin Abdullah, peace be upon you, I have read your letter and understood its contents and what you are calling for. I already knew that I already know that the coming of a prophet is still due, but I used to believe he would be born in Syria. I am sending you as presents to maids who come from noble Coptic families, clothing and a steed for riding. May peace be upon you." So he sent back gifts to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of these maids whom he sent was Maria radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Maria radiyallahu ta'ala anha, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through whom had a son named Ibrahim, who passed away shortly after he was born. And the ride which he gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a mule known as Duldul, which remained up till the time of Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This was the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Muqawqas, who did not embrace Islam, but he showed hospitality, he showed keen interest, he showed generosity to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. On the other hand, the king of Persia, the king of Iran at that time, was a total contrast to these two kings in his arrogance, in his haughtiness. And not only did he not embrace Islam, but he tore down the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent a letter to him telling, "In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful, from Muhammad the Messenger of Allah to Kisra, the King of Persia. To Kisra, the King of Persia, peace be upon him who follows the true guidance, believes in Allah and his Messenger, testifies that there is no God but Allah alone with no associate, and Muhammad is his servant and messenger. I invite you to accept the religion of Allah. I am the Messenger of Allah sent to all people in order that I may instill the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every living person, and that the charge may be proved against those who reject the truth. Accept Islam as your religion so that you may live in security. Otherwise, you will bear your sin as well as the sins of all the Majus, of all the fire worshippers, the people of your nation." Abdullah ibn Hudhafa al-Sahmi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was chosen to deliver this letter to the king, to Kisra. When Abdullah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu delivered this letter to Kisra, Kisra, rather than pondering over the contents of this letter with a peaceful and calm mind, he was outraged by the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has written his name, that is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's name, above the name of Kisra, because the letter began with the name from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Kisra. Outraged by this fact and overcome by ego and arrogance that prevented him from reading and contemplating on the contents of the letter, Kisra tore down the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and addressed him as a slave, that you slaves are challenging us. And he then rejected the Messenger of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu, not only did he do this, but he sent a message to his governors in the province of Yemen that, "I want this Prophet arrested and brought to me." He sent a message to Badhan, who was his governor and in charge of Yemen, because Yemen too at that time was under the rulership of Persia, that you must arrest this new Prophet and bring him to me. And Badhan set along with a few people to Medina in order to arrest the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And here Abdullah bin Hudhafa al-Sahmi radiyallahu ta'ala, and when he returned and informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of the happenings that took place with Kisra, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which he said, "O Allah, tear down his kingdom just like he tore my letter. Tear down his kingdom just like he tore down my letter." And from that very moment onwards began the decline of the Persian Empire that was considered to be one of the strongest empires in history. Imagine if disobedience to the Prophet ﷺ can prove to be so costly for an entire empire, for an entire kingdom. How about us who disobey the Prophet ﷺ throughout our lives in each and every aspect of our life? So the Prophet ﷺ made this dua against Kisra. When Bahdan came along with his men to arrest the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed generosity towards them, and he informed them that, "Oh Bahdan, go to your kingdom, and you'll find that your king has been murdered by his own son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has caused your king Kisra to perish." Bahdan was shocked, because if Kisra had truly died, the news couldn't reach the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam so quickly. And because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was informed through wahi, through revelation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed Bahdan. And when Bahdan went back to Persia and he finally found out that indeed the king has been killed and the killer is his own son, Bahdan was taken aback by the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he embraced Islam. The king did not embrace Islam, but Bahdan, who was an experienced leader, an experienced general, who was aware of the people and how truthful they are, Bahdan immediately returned to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he embraced Islam. And from that day onwards, the kingdom of Persia began to collapse. In the coming four years, more than 10 kings sat on the throne and left the throne. Finally, they united under the leadership of Yazdajurt, who was killed and whose armies were defeated when Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu became the Khalifa, and Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu took an army on the battlefield of Qadisiyah, killing Rustam and the other top generals of the kingdom of Persia. Finally, that led to Yazdajurd retreating from a city to the other, until finally he fled and was killed by some of his own people. And from that day onwards, the kingdom that had been there strong since centuries came to a decline, after which there was no rise for this kingdom. This was the incident of the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Kisra. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also dispatched a letter to Caesar, the king of Rome. And an interesting incident took place with regards to the letter to Caesar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose Dihya al-Kalbi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu to take this letter to Caesar. And at that time, incidentally, Caesar, whose main capital was perhaps Damascus, or Istanbul, which at that time was known as Constantinople, Caesar was at that time in Palestine, in Baytul Maqdis. And Hatib bin Abi Balta, or Dihya al-Kalbi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, took this letter to Caesar, and after contemplating on the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Caesar was a knowledgeable person, and he was already aware that the time of the coming of the Prophet has drawn near. The time of the coming of the new Prophet has drawn near, because he has knowledge of the previous scriptures. And so he was waiting the arrival of a new Prophet, but he was not aware whether this Prophet would be from the Arabs. So when this letter reached Caesar, unlike his counterpart, the king of Persia, Caesar contemplated on the contents of the letter. And this is what Allah has said in the Quran, لَتَجِدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. You would find in animosity, in hatred, the most severe people in hatred towards the Muslims are the Jews and the Kuffar, that is believers, the pagans. And you would find that in friendship, the most closest to them are the Christians. And therefore you see, An-Najashi embraced Islam. Muqawqas, who was a Christian, he did not embrace Islam, but he was hospitable to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Caesar, though he too did not embrace Islam, but he contemplated it. And he had come so close to embracing Islam that he was certain that the religion of Islam is the truth, but there were things that prevented him. So when Kisra got the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which read, "In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful," from Muhammad, the servant of Allah and his messenger, to Hercules, the king of the Byzantines, "Blessed are those who follow the true guidance. I invite you to embrace Islam so that you may live in security. If you come within the fold of Islam, Allah will give you double reward. But in case you turn your back upon it, then the burden of the sins of all your people shall fall upon your shoulders." And the same ayah was mentioned after it, "Qul ya ahlal kitabi ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa'in baynana wa baynakum." When Hercules read the contents of this letter, he wanted to investigate, he wanted more information about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Immediately he felt a great interest in the personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he sent out his people to find someone who was closely related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was present in the land of Syria. And his men returned with Abu Sufyan and his group, who had come there perhaps for some trade purposes. And Hercules made them stand before him, and he told that, "O Abu Sufyan," or he addressed them saying, "which of you is the most closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in lineage?" And Abu Sufyan said that, "O king, I am the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when it comes to lineage, when it comes to kinship." And then the king addressed them saying that, "I shall be asking you a few questions." And there was a translator between them. And he said that, "I shall be asking you a few questions, and you have to answer me truthfully and honestly." And he addressed the companions of Abu Sufyan and said that, "If this person speaks a lie, you have to immediately correct him. You have to immediately inform me that he is lying." And he made Abu Sufyan come closer to him, and he asked him several questions. And each of these questions, whenever Abu Sufyan answered any of these questions, Hercules was comparing the response of Abu Sufyan with the facts that he already had with him. And these questions which the king asked Abu Sufyan were: Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu himself narrates the entire incident after he embraced Islam. He says that, "Thumma kana awwal ma sa'alani anhu an qal," the first thing which the king asked me was, "Kayfa nasabuhu fikum," how is his lineage? How is the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Abu Sufyan said, "Huwa fina dhu nasabin." Abu Sufyan was afraid to lie. Abu Sufyan spoke the truth. Because Abu Sufyan himself said that nothing prevented me from lying against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except that if I lied on that occasion, the people would come back and tell my people over here that Abu Sufyan told lies over there. And I would feel ashamed and embarrassed when people say that Abu Sufyan lied in front of the king. So this prevented Abu Sufyan from speaking lies. So Abu Sufyan honestly replied to the questions of the king. And this was the first question. The second question which the king asked him was, "فَهَلْ قَالَ هَذَا الْقَوْلَ مِنْكُمْ أَحَدٌ قَطُّ قَبْلَهُ," has this claim made by anyone before him, the claim of prophethood, has anyone in your community in the Arabian Peninsula made a claim of prophethood before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Abu Sufyan said no. Then he asked him, "فَهَلْ كَانَ مِنْ آبَائِهِ مِنْ مَلِكٍ," was there a king among his forefathers? Was there a king among his forefathers? Abu Sufyan again said no. Then the king asked him, "فَأَشْرَافُ النَّاسِ يَتَّبِعُونَهُ أَمْ ضُعَفَاؤُهُمْ," are the rich ones, are the noble ones following this prophet, or are the weak people of the society following the Prophet? Abu Sufyan said that they are the weak ones. The weak ones are following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he said, أَيَزِيدُونَ أَمْ يَنْقُسُونَ Are they increasing in number or are their numbers declining? Abu Sufyan said, but they are increasing. Then he said, هَلْ يَرْتَدُّ أَحَدٌ مِّنْهُمْ سَخْطَةً لِدِينِهِ بَعْدَ أَنْ يَدْخُلَ فِيهِ Does anyone of them return from this religion? Does anyone of them become an apostate after entering this religion as a hatred for this religion? Does such incidents take place that a person entered this religion and after a few days he became angry upon this religion and left it? Abu Sufyan said, no, nothing of such sort has happened. Then the king further asked him different questions and finally he said that, what does he order you to do? What does he order you to do? The king also asked him that The king also asked him, هَلْ تَتَّهِمُونَهُ بِالْكَذِبِ Do you accuse him of lying? قَبْلَ أَنْ يَقُولَ مَا قَالَ Have you ever accused him of lying before he became a prophet? Before he became a prophet. Abu Sufyan said no. The king asked him, هَلْ يَغْدِرْ Does he break the covenants? Abu Sufyan again said no. Then he said, وَنَحْنُ مِنْهُ فِي مُدَّةٍ لَا نَدْرِي مَا هُوَ فَاعِلٌ فِيهَا But now we are in a truce and we do not know whether the Prophet ﷺ keeps up that truce or he breaks it. Then the king asked him, كَيْفَ كَانَ فَهَلْ قَاتَلْتُمُهُ Has there ever been fighting between you? Abu Sufyan said, yes. The king then asked him, فَكَيْفَ كَانَ قِتَالُكُمْ إِيَّهُ What was the result of that fighting? Abu Sufyan said, الْحَرْبُ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُ سِجَال That war is equal between us. At times he wins and at times we win. The king asked him, مَاذَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ What does he order you to do? Abu Sufyan said, he says, اعبدوا الله وحده ولا تشركوا به شيئا واتركوا ما يقول آباؤكم ويأمرنا بالصلاة والصدق والعفاف والصلة He orders us to worship Allah alone, not to associate anyone with Him and to leave all that our forefathers have been saying. And He orders us with Salah, with truthfulness, with chastity and with joining the ties of kinship. And then after the king had questioned him all of these questions, the king gave Abu Sufyan the reason why he asked him these questions. Hercules was a noble person, a man of knowledge. And whenever Abu Sufyan answered any of these questions, he was comparing his response to the facts that he already knew about the prophets, which made him reach to this conclusion that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the true prophet of Allah. The king then said to Abu Sufyan that first I asked you, how is his lineage? And you said that he is a man of good lineage. And so are the prophets. The prophets are sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the best of the lineage, in the most noblest of the families. And then the king said, then I asked you regarding this claim. Has anyone made this claim before him? And you said no. Had you said that someone has made the claim before him, I would have said that perhaps this prophet is a man who's trying to follow that person who has made a claim before him and trying to gain followers just like any person before him tried to gain followers. But however, if no one has made a claim of prophethood before him, this means that this person is truthful in his claim. And then I asked you that has there been a king in his forefathers and you said no. Had you said yes, I would have told that this person, through his claim of prophethood, is simply trying to gain the lost kingdom of his forefathers. But just as you said that there is no king in his forefathers, means that the person is truthful. And then I asked you that, are the weak ones following or are the Ashraful Nas following him? And you said the Zu'afa, the weak ones are following him. And so is the case of the prophets. And then I asked you regarding are they increasing and decreasing? And I asked you regarding does any one of them leave the religion after he enters it? And you said no. And so is the case with Iman. So is the case of belief. Once Iman enters the heart of a person and it enters into his blood and it mixes with the soul of a person, the bliss that a person gets from Iman, a person cannot ever leave that Iman. Once Iman enters the heart of a person cannot ever leave it. This is a sign of Iman. This is the trait of Iman, which is truly found in the Prophet and his companions. And then he said to him that, I ask you regarding his personality. Does he lie? Do you accuse him of lying? And you said, no. Imagine if a person is not accused of lying while speaking to the people around him. How can he lie when he informs something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When he says that Allah has sent me as a prophet. A person who does not lie while doing business transactions, how can he lie when he is saying that I am a prophet of Allah? And these are the things which Allah has revealed unto me when he's talking about Jannah and Jahannam. Indeed, he is a true prophet. When I asked you regarding what has the results of war between you been, and you said that war has been on equal terms between us. The king replied that so is the case with the prophets, that at times their enemies win and at times the prophets, but the final result comes out in favor of the prophets and his companions. This is what Hercules, the king of Rome, said to Abu Sufyan. And Abu Sufyan himself says that when I came out of the court of that king, I said to my companions that the matter of the prophet has reached to this extent that the king of Rome is afraid of him. And from that day onwards, Abu Sufyan began to believe that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will one day conquer over Makkah, until finally Abu Sufyan himself embraced Islam. And narrations, this is the narration of Sahih Bukhari. This incident has been recorded in Sahih Bukhari. It is also mentioned that after the king read the contents of this letter, he was so convinced that he said that if it was possible for me to go to that prophet and wash his feet, I would have gone to that prophet taking all the troubles and I would have washed his feet. He wanted to embrace Islam, but the love for his kingship or the pressure that he had as a king prevented him from embracing Islam. He asked that all the doors of the castle of the palace be closed. And then he made an announcement that, O people, the king has left Christianity and has become a Muslim. As soon as the people in the palace, in the castle, heard of this, they rushed towards the doors like wild cattle, like wild donkeys. And the king wanted to see what would the result be of his embracing Islam. Finally, when the king saw that if I embrace Islam, these are my subjects, this is my kingdom falling apart, leaving me alone, he was demotivated and he left the thought of embracing Islam. He made another announcement that, oh people, I was simply testing you, come back, for indeed I am a Christian. He made the second announcement, after which the people bowed down to him. However, deep within he knew, and he said that if it is a true prophet, he will indeed rule over the earth under my feet. This was what Caesar or Hercules believed, but he was prevented, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Whom Allah wants to guide, he guides, and whom he wants to go astray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes him to go astray. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also dispatched a letter to the king of Bahrain, to the other kings who responded to the invitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they embraced Islam. This was the incident of the letters with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dispatched to the various kings and rulers and emperors of those times. One thing that we see in all the letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how clearly the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed the message of Islam to these kings. And he made sure to mention this point that, O king, if you embrace Islam, you will have your reward and the reward of the people who follow you. But if you reject my message, you will have your sin and the sin of the people who are around you. This shows an important principle of Islam, that a person who sets an example of goodness and people follow him in that goodness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only rewards him for his deed, but also for the deeds of people who followed him in that act of goodness. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, مَنْ دَلَّ عَلَىٰ خَيْرٍ فَلَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِ فَاعِلِهِ. Whoever guides to that something which is good, he has the reward of the person who does it and follows it. And similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has also said, whoever man sanna fil islam sunnatan sayyi'atan, whoever does something evil and people follow him in that evil, he will have his sin and the sin of the people who follow him. And this is a moment to think about. This is something to think about. Many of the people did not give a second thought when they begin something evil. Doing something evil is evil, but beginning an evil and making way for others to commit that evil, causing that evil to spread, introducing that evil in the society, is one of the greatest sins. A person has the sins of his own self as well as the sins of the thousands others who follow him in that evil. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly stated to the different kings, if you reject my message and the people follow you in that rejection, you will have your sin and the sin of those who follow you in that rejection. Similarly, one of the important things that we understand from these letters is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam carefully chose the people who were dispatched to these kings. It was not random that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took any person and dispatched the letters with him, but he carefully chose the ambassadors who would be going to those kings. Similarly, one important thing that we come to know through this letter, which is in stark contrast to what we see in the Muslims today, and as we have several times mentioned, that learning the seerah increases understanding of the deen. We see many of the Muslims, they use the number 786, considering it to be an alternative for Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. If they are writing any letter or in printing invitation cards, rather than writing Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, they use the word 786 on their cars, on their vehicles. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, rather than this, 786. Because of some mathematical deductions, they came to know that the number 786 is the number of Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And when asked for a reason, why do you do this? They say, because if we write Bismillah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, the letter would be thrown somewhere, and this would cause it would cause disrespect to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, the name of Allah being thrown somewhere is disrespect to it. But consider this point, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while sending a letter to the kings who were apparently his enemies, to different kingdoms, who were non-believers, who were disbelievers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam simply wrote Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and he had the very same reason to fear, just like the Muslims are saying today. He feared that might be a king might tear down his letter, or he might step upon his letter. However, this did not prevent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from clearly writing Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So using alternative numbers, 786, 555 and other such numbers instead of Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is a bid'ah, is an innovation in the deen not used by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam nor his sahaba. Similarly, it's also possible, it's also permissible that a Muslim, he recites some Quran to a disbeliever so that he can listen to that Quran, he can translate that Quran for him so that he can understand what the Quran has to say. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed most of the kings saying, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ. These were the different letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to different kings. This also shows the level of tawakkul the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had. If we compare the small city of Medina, which was just like a small village compared to those mighty kingdoms, a person would think that it is extremely risky to challenge such kings, because you never know that any of these kings can send a small segment of his army which would be sufficient to destroy a small town like Medina. However, the trust which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, upon the promise of Allah, the promise of Allah which he used to announce in Makkah, that if you say la ilaha illallah and used hold upon it strongly, indeed you shall rule the Arabs and the Ajam, the Arabs and the non-Arabs. This shows the level of certainty, yaqeen and tawakkul with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, that he, despite the small means which the Muslims had, the weak position of the Muslims, this did not discourage him from inviting these kings to Islam. This is all that we come to know from the letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, these letters show that one of the main elements of a Muslim's life is da'wah, is invitation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inviting one and all, small and the big, to oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was the most important element in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as long as we uphold this responsibility of amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar, of inviting others to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because there are several others who simply are not Muslims because they do not have the knowledge of Islam. And once they come to know the truthfulness of Islam, you find their eyes flooded with tears upon knowing the truth. Hence, it becomes our responsibility, following the footsteps of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we use all that we have in our capability to spread the message of Islam. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given some of us leadership, He must use His leadership to convey the message of Islam to the other leaders. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given some of us some significant authority in the society, He must use that authority to convey the message of Islam. If someone of us is an average person, a normal person, he must use the close contacts that he has, and the fact that he can work at grassroots levels, he can use this fact to convey the message of Islam to the people, to the friends and neighbors around him. This should be one of the most important missions of our life. A life without inviting to the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a life that is vain, is a life that is nothing but vain, a life that is devoid of any mission. These were the important lessons that we get from the letters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the different kings. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He too instill in us the spirit of conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to one and all. Insha'Allah, we'll look in the coming episodes at the incidents that further took place after the Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the incident of the Battle of Khaybar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam focused his attention on the Jews of Khaybar and he fought with them. And what were the other incidents? Insha'Allah, in the coming episodes. Up till then, fi amanillah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.